weeks back, we had an annual accelerator, developer conference, which is called Postcon. We have Appcelerator as a worldwide presence. We see dynamic developers in all parts of the world. It's easy funded, so you can be rest assured of the conversation of the organization. Okay, web versus native. James also discussed this at length, and we all know it. Web and the internet has emerged as an unlikely duo. 10 years back, nobody could have predicted internet would evolve the way it has. Being a web developer is actually much easier than being a native developer because it's easy to develop for the web, it's easy to deploy. It's cross-platform as long as you can get your browser issues sorted out. The most important part is that it's built entirely on the standards, HTML, classic HTML, or now HTML5. That was one of the reasons why it was
partner.
There are basically four levels. At the very top level, you have all HTML, CSS, and JavaScript that is on web. Below that, you have API wrappers, which basically access your native device or desktop capabilities. So there are two diagrams of those. Titanium can be used for desktop development as well as mobile development. So there are APIs for those. Then there is a language to OS bridge that compiles the code into native application. And that is where we also have a part of the picture. There is a runtime shell. Finally, there is a runtime shell that packages your app for cross-platform distribution. So whether that's an Android APK or iOS IDE. Okay, this again is another presentation of the architecture. So the important thing here is the API that is segregated out. So you have user interface APIs which contains nothing to native UI components. So you would have all your usual UI components like an app bar, app bar, menus, dialogs. And then you have a phone API which basically gets you access to the native APIs. Geolocation, accelerator, sound, file system, that kind of system. Okay, so before I talk about Android, how we will develop Titanium, Android apps with Titanium. I just want to touch upon the basic characteristics of an Android application interface and an iOS application interface. So Android applications, as we know, are touch and hardware interaction in the infamous background. Then activities are the central elements. Everything in your Android app involves on activities. Courtesy, fragmentation, and device sizes. From 3 inches now to 10 inches, there is no, absolutely no homogeneity in interfaces. It's a pain for developers. And finally, as Samson puts it, it is for interfaces for people. It's not for humans. On the other hand, iOS is more web-centric. Everything is all about gestures. There is, despite iPad minis and the iPhone 5 different resolutions, there is still pretty much a lot of uniformity in terms of UI conventions and Apple believes in issuing human interface guidelines as opposed to. Okay, so, so one of the important things that you need to do with Titanium is when you're especially doing cross platform development, so you're creating an app which has to work with Android as well as iOS, is that once I hear cross-platform UI, so the way you do it is still focus on your primary task and create an information architecture for your app on both platforms and then use the corresponding UI elements on each platform. There is a wrapper for almost every UI component that you have in Android and iOS. So a quick brush up of, I'm sure all of you are Android developers, so you already know this, but I'll still do a quick walkthrough of basic Android concepts. So these are same irrespective of whether you are developing with Titanium or not. So you have the direction of all of the activities, just like you have different filters, and then your various API levels, each offering different capabilities. You usually pass on data, serialize data, and pass it between activities. You would have actions, categories, class names and services. The way your app works is it maintains a task stack. The task stack is what defines your screen navigation. There is one activity which defines your application entry point. release more into a specific folder. And whatever your native resources are, there is a specific folder platform and other resources. So this is basically an example of a TIR or XML. I think I got my form wrong. It's very similar to Android manifest for XML. You find plenty of examples on the Appcelerator website. Okay, so Red Onion uses two JavaScript engines, Rhino and V8. This slide is a bit old, so actually V8 is now also in use, and you can actually switch back either Rhino or V8 depending on whichever JavaScript engine you want. V8, as you obviously might know, is much faster. Okay, what is Red Onion Studio? In case, I'm sure everybody here has heard of Eclipse. There used to be a wrapper over Eclipse called Appana Studio, and that's one company which Red Onion Appcelerator acquired, and they bundled it in a product and called it Red Onion Studio. So that's the primary IDE in which you would type and develop mobile apps using Red Onion. You'll see a lot of it in the next session. Setting up Red Onion Studio is very easy. Just go to developer.appcelerator.com, download the file. Rest of it is all point and click. Using Red Onion Studio, again, it's very similar to Eclipse. Where if you have used Eclipse, it should be easy. You have preferences where you can configure your Android SDK. That's pretty much what you need. Once you've done that, you have to go to the Hello World Red Onion. Why Red Onion? It's free, free as NPL, it's open source, it's licensed under Apache. There is a thriving developer community, there is excellent support available in case you get stuck. There is a developer forum, there is a Twitter handle which usually responds to all queries within one day. And there are also commercial training and support services available. Why Red Onion? So what is the sweet spot for Red Onion? Obviously, if you are planning to build the next angry words, Red Onion is not the right framework to do that. It's optimal if you are creating an application which is a typical client-server application which uses a lot of data, whether it's XML or JSON between client and server. If you are creating a web service mashup, again, Red Onion is a good option. Social utilities, light social utilities, if you are creating casual games, not very graphic sensitive, or anything in general that you want to create on multiple platforms, definitely evaluate right now. Okay, so as I mentioned, a thriving developer community, and I learned this group, I remember it shows 2000 registered developers, but I learned a bit earlier than that, and it was a few hundred, so now it's 300k registered developers. That's okay, you can see. Why Red Onion? You'll see a number of apps which have been built using Red Onion, and are featured regularly on the Apple App Store as well as the top apps. Okay, what one of the major UI pains is that in building cross-platform applications is that you do not obviously want to have a back button in your iOS app, but you need it on your Android app. So the way Red Onion does it is that you can create your UI in a sense. If you use the wrappers for Android, it will show you the Android UI. iOS, shows you the iOS UI. So there is no conflict of interest as far as user interface is concerned. This is a case study on an app called Rebindo, which was built using Red Onion. So this gentleman wants to know, is in a foreign country and wants to know the location of the car. So this developer actually started off working on it, and as you can see, he worked really hard, and he built this graphic engine. Then it was decided that he'll rewrite it without the VLS and without native development, right? Using a typically agile fashion, this was what was eventually built in 2 weeks and in 50 iterations. So this is in a nutshell, which is all about my presentation. If there are any questions, please go ahead.
Talk about the integration for the Android and the activities that is a wrapper of the Android and Android. What are the things available on an iPhone?
So it's a similar
itself from it, although it's possible. Do I use a separate code for both of them?
Yes, you have to write a separate code for both of them, but it is as long as you are using the right. So it is only for proprietary frameworks. For example, if I have to use Core Audio, so that's just an iOS iOS framework. It's not an Android framework. In that case, I use that wrapper. But there are a number of common wrappers. So for example, any file operation that you do is in a common framework, is in a common package which you can use across iOS and Android. So some of your questions will actually be answered as part of the next session, because that is where we'll actually show a Android app using Titanium.
platform and
registration
process. Also,